firearms friends. Joel Colander with Rock Island Auction Company, here to tell you about some interesting pieces of Curiosa that we have coming up in the 2018 June Regional Auction. As you can tell by the pieces on the table in front of me, the name of the game today is cane guns. Of course, in the 1850s, canes, without the firearm, just canes in and of themselves, were signs of social status. They were well-to-do gentlemen would carry a cane. Also around that same time, 1850s, there was a large rise in urban crime. So perhaps it was only natural that the social status of the day and the need for self-protection melded together to make the cane gun. Now, like most pieces of Curiosa, the cane gun is an answer to a very real problem, but it's not often the best answer to a problem. By the 1850s, of course, we already had revolver firearms like the Colt 1849 Pocket, which would have, of course, provided more firepower and done it in a compact size as well. But for a gentleman, I suppose, who still wanted the sign of social status and didn't want to carry a revolver or Derringer in his coat pocket, the cane gun was a very real possibility. Now, the most known of these is, of course, the Remington cane gun, an example of which I happen to have over here. The Remington cane gun, also called the Thomas Patent cane gun, came about just prior to the Civil War. They were being manufactured. They, of course, stopped during the Civil War when other arms were more necessary, and then resumed production afterwards. They come in a variety of colors and a beautiful selection of cane heads. There's a smaller dog size, there's larger, there are duck heads carved out of ivory, there's a claw and ball, there's very beautiful pieces. And again, fine pieces of Curiosa that also are neat pieces in American firearms history. Remington was the only major manufacturer to produce them during that time. There were, of course, other manufacturers prior to then, and that was one way Remington decided to kind of put his toe in the water for the civilian market at the time. And it is also Remington's first rimfire long gun. So very neat place in firearms history, a beautiful piece of Curiosa. This particular one, however, we're offering in our September 2018 Premier Firearms Auction, so keep your eye out for that one. So we're not gonna talk about the Remington, the Thomas Patent today. We could do an entire video just on that, and if you guys comment enough in the comments below, maybe we will. But for now, let's take a look at the two in the June regional, a Dumonthier cane gun and a Riley cane gun of London. First and foremost is this very good looking cane gun made by Dumonthier of Paris. That would be Joseph Celestin Dumonthier. And as we've mentioned earlier in other blogs and other topics, we've covered Dumonthier before with his knife pistols, as well as he made a very nice cutlass revolver, very mean looking firearms. And this sort of continues that tradition of curio firearms being very, very well made. Now, my sources on Dumonthier, both the production of the cane guns and his company as a whole, varied pretty wildly, so I'll stay away from some of the production numbers and dates other than what we have right here in our hand. Now, this one we know for sure was patented in December of 1876, making it the latest comer to the cane gun game of the items we had here on the table, Remington being of that pre and post Civil War era, and the Riley of London being much, much earlier, but we'll get into that in a little bit. Montier has this very nice hardwood exterior, pretty attractive staghorn handle, and it's fired simply by giving a 45 degree twist, and it kind of cams open and shut, and then pulling it open. When you look inside, you'll see on the back there is a firing pin. Oddly, it is for center fire. Now, Dumonthier made cane guns in a variety of calibers and makes. He would eventually go on to make them in like a 410 shot shell size. Most cane guns are rimfired, so to see a center fire pin is pretty unusual. This one in a 38 caliber. And once you've done with that, you essentially shut it back up again, give it another twist to secure it, and then there's a small button by this collar that had the patent dates on it, as well as the firing device. Also on this one of note is the serial number 159, so making that a pretty early example of the DeMonte patent as a whole for his cane guns. Also, looking down the barrel of a Borlite, we can see it has some similarities to the Remington, to the Thomas patents that came before it, meaning there is a portion of it that's rifled in the initial part of the barrel, and then afterwards, at least the Remington would change materials and went to a smoothbore. This clearly does the same with a rifled beginning and a smoothbore end. Now, so far, there have been some similarities between the Remington and the DuMontier, and even in the 10-ish years between, we've already seen some advances where the Remington has to be unscrewed to be loaded with a rimfire cartridge, screwed closed, then cocked to produce a trigger. The DuMontier is now to a twist open breech. You're inserting a center fire cartridge, pushing the other to produce a cartridge. Both fine firearms, both very high quality, as perhaps you would expect to pitch to a well-to-do market. However, the earliest gun on the table dates back to about the 1850s, so we're looking at 25 years before the DuMontier and another 10 before the Remington. It is, of course, a European design. This is from Riley of London, who did a lot of very, very neat things, not only with firearms, but also with explosive ordnance shells. Very cool things, but he started off in about 1816 as a jeweler, would eventually take his son on to the business. They would separate and do their own thing. His son would take on more ornate and well-decorated, gold-decorated firearms, and the father would continue to produce firearms under license for several companies we've heard of, Adams Revolvers and the like, Tranter. But in 1850, and this may be tipping things the hat a little bit, 1850 they were already prolific in the manufacture of pneumatic guns. So this cane gun is actually an air gun. They exhibited their pneumatic cane gun at the Great Exhibition of 1851, and the quote is they were overcome with orders. So to say it was popular is an understatement, but for how popular it is, it was a new device. It was very cool. Early adopters, however, did not enjoy the practicality that the DuMontier and that the Remington would provide in later years. You may be able to tell that because of some of the additional equipment that we have here on the table required to operate the Riley cane gun. And here we have the Riley pneumatic cane gun. As you may be able to tell already, we're going to have our hands full. We can barely fit this one in frame. But if you were going to use this for a night out on the town, you would of course want to make sure your reservoir is fully charged. So you take the two halves of the cane and unscrew them. Here we have our coupling with the nice Riley of London marking, and it looks a lot like other pneumatic couplings of the time and earlier. Make sure we have a good seal, good strong threads. To fill this, first of all, this is sturdy metal. This is not a bamboo or a hardwood covering like we had in the DuMontier. This is metal. This is a metal reservoir necessary to hold the pressures that are in there. It has a horn cap. Even if you weren't ready to use this immediately, this would make a pretty substantial striking weapon. To fill the reservoir, you are going to take a tool that looks a lot like this, sort of like a bicycle pump without a bottom. And of course, it functions in much the same way. We have our male and female ends of the pneumatic coupling, which you join together eventually. And pump away. Boy, we're definitely not getting all that in the screen, are we? But once you finish filling your pneumatic reservoir at home and not in a high stress situation, you could then rejoin the two halves of the cane. Again, very well machined screws. So now you have a sufficient charge of air, you'd want to load the firearm. And loading, you notice we didn't have a loading area back when we disassembled the cane like our other ones, because this is not a cartridge firearm. This is, in fact, since it is pneumatic, we have a brass plug, which also protects the muzzle and barrel, and just a ramrod on the end of it. So you'd throw a ball down the barrel and ram it home. Should you need to use your Riley pneumatic cane gun in the event of ruffians, you would want to unscrew your brass end very, very quickly. You could take aim using the very, very tiny rear and front sights. There's the rear, the front is up here, just little more than a metal nub. If anything, they help with positioning, perhaps, the cane gun, since as sights, they are not exceptionally useful. And then you have, of course, your firing mechanism, which is here. But notice it's recessed. In order to produce the firing mechanism, you need another tool. This is obviously a modern reproduction, a little square-headed driver here that you would insert into this hole here and give it a little twist, and the push button trigger will pop out, allowing you to fire the gun. Now, you could use the sights, but that would involve holding this horn cap up by your eye, and I know pneumatic guns don't have the kick as their gunpowder counterparts, but that could still come back and make it look like you've met ruffians, even if you haven't. I would feel much safer holding this at the hip, even though when you do hold it like a traditional rifle, that push button trigger is exactly where your front hand would fall on a four stock of a traditional rifle. So, again, not as quick to implement the Riley, but it would, of course, be relatively quieter than the gunpowder counterparts. There would be no smoke that you would see in the gunpowder counterparts, ultimately making it more concealable than later cane gun designs. Now, should you desire a cane gun today, you can go with older collectible models such as this, but there are, of course, still modern cane guns being made today. Of course, if you do buy a modern cane gun, there is the associated paperwork of having a disguised weapon or any other weapon, so do be aware if you do want a modern cane gun or any disguised weapon, there is some additional paperwork. Ones that were made before then are obviously grandfathered, or you could just get a pneumatic cane gun and avoid that altogether. Well, we hope this exposed you to a couple different variations of cane gun besides the Remingtons that are more well known, especially in the stateside. If you enjoyed, please click that subscribe button below. You can check out the full catalog listings and more photos at rockislandauction.com. And until next time, keep your powder dry.